Thank you very much, Marco. Just on time, so it's very good. Now we'll go to the next session, and it's not David for sure. Edwin. Edwin is on behalf of European Cockpit Associations. Tackle the last session of the day, and I hope you will still follow. I know you're all tired and looking forward to the networking event. And it's about a very important topic, evidence-based training. So the floor is yours, Edwin. Thank you.
Thank you, David. Good afternoon, everybody. I'm the last speaker, so please stay with me. My name is Edwin Tasma, as David's already said. I'm a member of the European Cockpit Association, and we represent all the pilots in Europe, in the specific case, the helicopter pilots in Europe. As David already said, if you look at the notes, everybody's talking about David Abad. He's a Spanish pilot. He's also a member of the rulemaking task for evidence-based training. So he actually is our specialist within the ACA. But I already told you he's a pilot, so what do most pilots? They fly helicopters. And he had to fly helicopters today, so he wasn't able to be here. And he asked me to be here instead of him. So I hope I can make some sense of it. It's not my specialty, but I will try to do my best. What we want to do is to share our view as pilots about EBT, but we think it's very important. It's the next step in how to train pilots instead of check pilots. And we're looking forward to the EBT mixed implementation, as EASA calls it. If you look at this picture, you see a lot of different type of helicopters. You see a lot of different types of cockpits. You see a lot of different types of automation, of interface integration. You have offshore flights, you have search and rescue flights, you have HEMS flights. It's all different environments they fly in. And also, if you look at the pilots, they can have different backgrounds. They can be low time, they can be high time, they can be military, they can be civilian. So it's all different. They also fly in unique environments. You know, for instance, you can do one flight as a crew as flying offshore, and the next flight you have to search and rescue with the same helicopter in the same situation. So the big question is, why is everything is different? Why do we train them in the same way? That doesn't make sense whatsoever. So I think so. That's why evidence-based training is a very huge step forward in training pilots. Now, the first question, of course, is what is evidence-based training? Well, I think the first one you can guess is evidence. Because you want to have some evidence to see what the pilots are doing, what the level of expertise is, and where do you get that evidence from? You can get that from your safety management system in your company, or you get it from safety reports, because pilots are obliged to make safety reports when things go wrong. The bigger companies have flight data monitoring, so the pilots give you free information on what they are doing on shore or in flight, and you can see that you're drifting to a certain area where you don't want to go to, so you can take action. And also during the training, you can see what the level of competence is of that crew, of that pilot. The next thing you have to look at is your operational risk. As you said, you can have different types of operations. If you fly with HEMS, you can fly in between mountains. It's a completely different risk when you fly offshore into the night to a small island with a lot of wind and rain and bad weather. So you need to know what your operational risks are in your operation. That's very important. But also, you have to look at the competencies required to cope with those risks. What companies need the crew to manage all those risks involved in that operations? I will come back to the competence a little bit later in the next slide. If you put it all in a blender and mix it all up, at the end, you can produce a tailored training for the specific crew or for the specific operation, for the specific helicopter. And that's what evidence-based training is about. As I said, I want to talk to you a little bit more about competence. I can read it out for you. It's competence means a dimension of human performance that is used to reliably predict successful performance on the job. A competency is manifested and observed through behaviors that mobilize the relevant knowledge, skills and attitudes to carry out activities or tasks under specific conditions. So you have the skills, the knowledge and attitudes are the three most important things for a crew. And what are we training now? We are now most of the time training only the skills. So we give you you give you a flight, you get an emergency, you have to push some buttons and you land the aircraft and applause, you managed to save this helicopter. But we hardly train anything on knowledge. We give some sort of knowledge, but not that much. But we train at the moment not whatsoever on attitudes of crews. You can say attitudes, but what about human factors? Because pilots are trained in human factors. Every year you have to go to the human factors class and to train what human factors are. But the problem with that is you go to in a classroom and they can explain to you what human factors are when you have an experienced captain and a low-time co-pilot, or an experienced captain or experienced co-pilot and low-time captain, what can be the interaction. That's nice. You go out of the classroom, you go into a cockpit, and then you can start doing the skills again. So you don't take the human factors into the cockpit with training. You don't look at the interaction of the crew. You don't look at the decision-making they do during the flight. And you don't have to manage the workload. How do you manage the workload? You don't have any rating for that at the moment. So if what we now see is what EASA calls the mixed evidence-based training. And it's used that by EASA to allow an operator to start implementing evidence-based training, but merge it with the legacy training at the moment. So what you have is the standard proficiency checks, what we have at the moment, the line training proficiency checks and the operational proficiency checks. The mixed part of it is that you combine it with the legacy training. So you use the standard proficiency check forms, how to observe your pilots. But the beauty of it, this is now what we normally do. We go to a simulator, we start training emergencies, you land the aircraft, and at the end of the 2 hours training or 4 hours training, you get a notice if you make your exam or not. If you didn't make your exam, you have a problem because you have to come back again. And we pilots, as control freaks, don't like that message, but that's the case now. If you look at what we are going to do now, is that your first hour of simulator training is evaluation phase. We give the pilots the normal operation, a flight for the normal operation. So if you are an HEMS pilot, you get a HEMS operation. If you are a SAR pilot, you get a SAR pilot, and so on and so on. During the flight, we give you a small emergency, and then the instructor is going to look how you handle that emergency. What's your decision making? How do you cope with all the workload and all that stuff? After the evaluation, the instructor will tell you if you managed to do this flight properly. So at that moment, you already know that you're going to succeed your prof check or not. So you already failed or not failed. If you're failed, you have time to train. So it's not the end of the story, so you have time to train. So at the end, you'll be going to be a good pilot again. The second part, after the evaluation, you have a 1 hour of maneuvering training and maneuvering validation. So that's the old stuff. You're going to do flight training, you're going to do emergency reaction and all that stuff. And that, of course, you also have to succeed, but that's a little bit less important, or not less important, but less exciting, because that's something you can train for. Now, after the day one, you have evaluation and a maintenance training, maneuvering training and validation. And then the instructor can see that you're lacking, for instance, decision-making, that typical crew lacking decision-making, or the typical crew lacking handling the emergency or wherever. At that moment, the trainer can say, okay, I need to train those guys a little bit on, for instance, decision making. So the last 2 hours of flight training, you're gonna do a scenario-based training. And with that training, for instance, if making decision is a difficult part for their crew or they need some training, that they pick out the training flight where decision making is an important factor on how to train it. So what you see here is that you don't just check the pilot, but you look at what his competencies are and how to train him. So I think that it's very important you train the pilot to become better instead of just checking in on his skills. What are the key elements of the mixed evidence-based training? I think if you look at the first one is competency framework. If you look at the ICAO as a document, the 9095, all the competence training framework are in it. The grading system are in it. So there is a list of competency required, the observable behaviors in it. And we as pilots and we as European competition emphasize that you use that standard network or framework, because if you start using, come up with your own, it's a belief that you have as company, but those frameworks are based on a lot of knowledge and a lot of research done by rulemaking tasks, wherever they look at thousands of accidents, and so it's a well thought and well based on information. What is also very important, if you have those competency framework and grading system, now you have to have trainers and instructors know how to instruct. Because it's not just looking at if he uses the wrong button or the right button, but he also has to know a lot of knowledge about human factors. So instead of having a human factor guy in a classroom and a trainer in a simulator, now you have a trainer who has to do both. He has to do human factors and also has to look at the instrumentation of the training part. So it's important that instructors are properly trained. That probably means that not all the instructors that we have now are suitable to do this. So we have to look at that very, very carefully. And also instructors should be standardized. They should all look at the same manner at level of competencies and all that stuff. It should be standardized. I think we cannot, as European competition, cannot emphasize it enough. If you look at the some experience we have, I'm not going to mention any names in the fixed wing world, is that when one group, the instructors were properly trained and did the perfect job, and then EBT worked, and the other guys were the old instructors and then we could do it all the way we always did it, and it didn't work. So it's very important that all those instructors are trained properly. I cannot emphasize that enough. And the second part of it is, if that's all in place, you have the proper instructors, then you need to create some pilot material and instructor material. So what does the pilot need to know before he goes into the simulator? What does the instructor need to know before he goes into simulator? How should he train it? So you have to develop also a program. Which program, which type of flights do you present to the crew and all that stuff. If that's all in place, then you have the mixed EBT, is those two lines. If that's all in place, you have to go to your local CAA and they have to approve it. And now we have also a line number three, and that's the future thing. What's going on now is that the rulemaking task, they have a thousand accidents we're looking at it, and 80% of all those accidents attitude was in fact a cause for the accident. So attitude is very important, so they find that out. And now what after this all this information gathering is going to be done and it's probably I think next year, then the EASA will deliver and indicates what maneuvers are required, what competency are required, and what phase of flights are required for the type of helicopter you're operating. And the type of helicopter you're operating means the level of automation that's in the helicopter, because you have different level of automation in the helicopter, and it also requires different programs to train. This is what's called the baseline, and for every type of helicopter, they have a baseline program, EASA, and the only thing the operator needs to do is to adopt this program to the helicopter type he's flying and the type of operation he's flying. And to come up with the conclusion, I said just data justifies evidence-based training helicopters. I didn't show you any data because I didn't manage to get the graphs, but what you see is that 80% of all accidents were the major contributors were the competencies and attitudes of the pilots. It's not because they don't know how to fly helicopters, but it's their attitude that creates the problem and making it worse. They did some trials by several organizations, and it was fit for purpose. They were very happy with it, and it works. They noticed it. But we want to emphasize what's very important, and I can't stress that enough, is that instructors should be trained properly. I think that's the key for a successful evidence-based training program. That's hopefully everybody's working. Yeah, nobody's sleeping. That's nice. It's the end of my presentation. Thank you very much.